Hey Devin, cool story. Back when I was 18, I was visited by a traveling wizard. He said that he would cast a spell for me to either give me a huge penis or a great memory. Unfortunately, I forget which one I chose. Oh my god.
That is... We're off to a great start. This is going to be a very serious droll podcast about tell already.
That might be my worst of my jokes. But truthfully, I absolutely love it. Hey, everybody. Welcome to What Magic Is This? A podcast about magic, the occult, the esoteric, the paranormal, the supernatural, and the weird. My name is Douglas, and on this show, we're gonna let our beards down a little bit. This show's been so serious recently, so I thought that let's have a bit of a fresh air in here. So we're gonna have a bit of fun with this podcast. I am joined today by a wizard. A wizard, that's right. Blurring the line between fantasy and reality, bringing magic, wisdom, and fun as only a wizard can to places like the New York subway, as well as events, a master of meditation and hypnosis, who has the audacity to bring humor and playful pragmatism into the world, I am joined by Devin Person. Devin, how are you?
I'm wonderful. It's so good to share this virtual conversational space with you.
Right. Yeah. So Devin, you reached out to me ages ago, and I've been wanting to have you on the show. A lot of things have just come up, and I'm so thankful that you're able to join. We've already had, like, I feel like we've already talked for 4 hours before we even turned the mics on. So I'm super excited to have you here.
I'm excited to be here. Yeah. I think, you know, it's one of those things that you got to plant the seed and then be patient. And then, you know, before you know it, you're eating that delicious fruit.
Absolutely. So before we begin, do you want to tell us a little bit about why you call yourself a wizard, sir?
Sure. So I think I'm very similar to you. Like, we were talking about this before the show. When I was 18, I read an interview in Arthur magazine with Grant Morrison about chaos magic. And I was like, I have always been interested in religion. I've always been interested in this idea of magic and the materialist explanation that people do this stuff because they're silly and stupid and superstitious and wrong. I was like, that's a lot of, you know, in a small, like, tribe where resources are scarce, that's a lot of wasted energy into something that's giving you no value. Like, I don't buy that. And so when suddenly I got this more psychological chaos magic-y explanation of magic, it clicked, and I started reading Robert Anton Wilson, and I started just going down that path and was like, this is great. And for most of my 20s, magic was something I did in private. It was a personal practice that I used to kind of get over bad habits and navigate, you know, events in my life. And every once in a while, I would go out to a bar, I would get a little bit drunk, and I would be like, all right, let me tell you how I think the universe really works. And I would talk about magic. And I moved to New York, and I had a, you know, kind of Saturn return quarter life crisis moment where I was like, I've done a bunch of different random things in my 20s, and I'm really looking for, like, what my next move is going to be. And I want something that I can stick with. I want something that I can really grow for a long time. I don't want to do a project for 2 years and get bored with it. I was thinking a lot about, like, novelty Twitter accounts, and I was like, God, how awful that must be to have a popular novelty Twitter account, and you're like 3 years in and you're like, I can't make any more modern Seinfeld jokes. This is so, I'm so over this. This is awful, but, like, this is what I do. Ugh. And so I wanted something that was interesting. And I thought a lot about this idea of, what do I want to be when I grow up? Right. Well, when's grown up? And I said, well, if grown up is very, very old, then I have a lot of buffer to figure this out. I can move very slowly. And eventually I sort of settled on this idea of, I've always been into wizards. I've always loved that archetype.
Right.
And if I unite myself with that archetype, that could be a very mutually beneficial deal. So for me, I know that, like, you know, if you have a friend that's very into Star Trek, everybody knows what's to get that friend for their birthday. Right. Everybody sees the meme about Star Trek. It's on that Facebook wall, and you look down the wall and you're like, oh, someone's already posted it. You know,
right.
It gives people a handle. So I knew if I identified myself as a wizard, it would make me legible in a different way than just as a regular person.
Got it. So
people would be able to say, hey, I'm friends with a wizard, or there's a wizard coming to the party. And that would work out well for me. It would be sort of a, you know, great ad campaign.
Right.
And then on the other side, the wizard archetype as this thing that lives in the cultural consciousness of human beings, that would benefit by me being a spokesperson for it and helping that idea grow and spread. And so I performed a ritual where I thought, I don't think I can use magic to change my life so far. I don't think I can change, you know, where I am in this exact moment. I don't think I could suddenly cast the spell and now I'm a different person in a better house, fabulously rich, and, you know, everything's different. And if I did, what happened to the old me that was just existing? Did I just kill that off? You know, there's a lot of ethical questions there.
Right.
But if I look out into the future, I can see all of these different possibilities, from the ones that are very short paths of possibilities where I die the next day,
right,
get hit by a bus crossing the street,
yeah,
to the ones where I'm, you know, the most famous, successful, rich person that's ever lived, to the ones where I'm an awful drug dealing scumbag, to ones where, you know, and anything that I could imagine is theoretically possible.
Right.
And out of all of those possibilities, I was like, there's a really odd bunch where I decide to become a wizard. Uh-huh. And out of that bunch, there's got to be one that's the best version of all of them. Like this golden thread where I succeed in becoming a wizard, things fall into place. My life follows this very awesome narrative. Eventually I'm very old, I'm on my deathbed, and I am the most powerful wizard version of myself that I could ever dream of becoming.
Right.
And I was like, that guy has got magic. Like that's the most magical person I can imagine. So if anyone's gonna help me become a wizard, it's that guy. So I basically, like the Neil Young song, I said, hey, old man, take a look at my life. I'm you that hasn't grown up yet. So help me and you'll exist. And this is going to work out great for both of us.
Yeah.
So I summoned my future wizard self and I cast myself onto this path and said, I'm going to live my life as a wizard and I'm going to align myself with this archetype. Very, you know, literally, I wear wizard robes. I have a beard and a pointed cap.
Yeah.
And I'm going to see what this goes, because I think that's going to be a lot more fun than the other projects I could come up with. I mean, the world's got enough bloggers. Like, I don't think the world has enough wizards.
I would totally agree with you. So, as you mentioned, you do dress in what can be considered a somewhat archetypical depiction of a wizard. You've got a beard. It's awesome. It's white. You have a robe. You got the pointed hat. Do you walk around with the staff at all, or is that considered a weapon?
I've been waiting for a staff to manifest, and I've had a few times where, like, there's these staffs that have like a little old man wizard face carved into it.
Right.
And I've seen them and I'm like, man, this is so cool. But I need to wait until it like magically comes to me.
Absolutely.
And I recently got injured and one of our friends in Kentucky sent us a photo. She's like, found this at a thrift store for you. And it's one of those staffs. So it's waiting for me back home in Kentucky right now.
Oh,
so,
amazing.
Yeah. New chapter.
New chapter.
Watch out, indeed. World. I got a staff.
But the reason I bring this up is, what is it about wizards that is seemingly automatically recognizable and endearing to many of us?
Well, I mean, that's a very complex philosophical question. Mm-hmm. It takes us back to like Platonism of, you know, what makes a chair a chair? You know, is there this ideal chair that exists and there's like the one true chair? Yeah. Or, you know, is a three-legged chair a chair? Is a chair that's got no legs and on the ground a chair? Like, how do you define that?
Right.
And we don't have to try and define that, because I think it's almost like the famous judge saying about part like obscenity, I know it when I see it. People know a wizard when they see it.
Yeah.
And there's the set of signals that we have that have evolved through culture from, I think we'll talk about today, from both actual history of magic and fiction, which I think is equally important. The way that we explore ideas about magic is magic itself. And so there are these signifiers that we have learned to recognize, and a pointed hat, you know, robes, long billowing sleeves. When you see that, even a little child will go, that's a wizard.
Right.
And that has been my goal. Every time I've designed a set of robes, I tell the costume designer, I'm like, I want to make it look cool. I want to make it look modern and fun, but it has to achieve one goal, and that someone has to be able to say, that's a wizard. Right. I don't want someone to go, what's that druid doing? Or like, is that a monk, mommy? No, that's a wizard. And so this is an idea that is just in our head somewhere, the same way that, how do you recognize a tomato? You know, there's a lot of different kinds of tomatoes, but most of us are pretty good at saying, oh, that red thing with the little green leaves at the top, that's a tomato.
Right.
And I have harnessed the wizard archetype in the same way to align myself with that and make myself, again, legible in a cultural level where, you know, you could say a picture of me and you say, that looks like a wizard.
Right. Right. Could you tell us about the origin of the word wizard?
Yeah, so wizard is a word that comes to us from Middle English, and there's the root is wiz or wise, and then the erd ending just means one who is. So the classic example is, you can get drunk, And then a drunkard is one who is drunk. And so a wizard is one who is wise. So that was, I think, a word that kind of evolved to just describe, you know, someone who was wise, someone who had that little spark of knowledge, someone who is worth going to for counsel or maybe some magical assistance. And then I actually reached out to your former guest and my good friend Al Cummins to talk about this, of like, how commonly was this used? And the gist of it, I think, is it was not like every medieval village was like, ah, there's a wizard who lives in a tower with an owl and has like a blue hat with stars on it. But it was a word among words that was used to describe these cunning folk and conjurers and charm workers and all of these sorts of things. And what's interesting about language is you'll often have a diversity that over time sort of narrows down. Yeah. And the good example of that is like in the 1960s, if you teleported back into like 1967, hippie was not the default word.
Correct.
Long hairs, freaks. Like there were all of these other things that people were using to call it. But once you move forward and one word becomes kind of dominant, then that takes over. I read an article recently that was written in like maybe like 2011, and they kept talking about Gen Y. We don't say Gen Y anymore. We say millennial. And so Gen Y now seems weird. So I think wizard is this one word amongst many that has kind of taken on a life of its own and gone past its original context and grown into this thing that especially explodes with the presentation of fictional wizards that we get from Tolkien and then Dungeons and Dragons and then, you know, the whole fantasy canon as it exists today.
Absolutely. And you nailed it there. So it is said that back in the day, the distinctions between philosophy and magic was less distinct. And if you were a wise person, you were almost like you were automatically considered to be somehow magical, which is, I get it. And I like it quite a bit. But wizard was, yeah, it was really only something that was used sparingly from about 1550 to the 19th century. What do you think accounts for the, shall we say, somewhat short period of time for wizard to be basically part of a cultural lexicon? If you live in the Western world and you say the word wizard, we all know what it means.
Mm-hmm. So I think it really, I think Tolkien is a big one. Yeah. I think there are these sort of, it's not quite a bottleneck. It's like the opposite. It's like this point where, you know, an idea passes through and then explodes. And so I know that Tolkien got his vision of Gandalf. A lot of it's borrowed from depictions of Odin, of artwork of like Odin as this wanderer with this broad brimmed hat and this long beard and all of that kind of stuff. So I think Tolkien is a really big part of that. Yeah. And that kind of connects with other ideas that were floating around about, you know, Renaissance magicians and these ideas of wizards. So like fact and fiction kind of blend together. And it struck a chord. It was one of those things, you know, like, why does one song go viral? Like, why does something just suddenly resonate with the moment and everybody is like, that's the thing that we want to latch onto? We're all going to watch Tiger King and Bake Sourdough at the beginning of the pandemic. Like, why does one thing just explode? And so I think from Tolkien, he really tapped into this kind of fantasy idea and really birthed the modern fantasy genre as we know it, which then other people played around with those same ideas in that same world. And then I think Gary Gygax in Dungeons and Dragons really brought that into people's lives in a way that was exciting. Yeah. Like, this is an alternate world that you don't have to just escape into by yourself with your nose in a book. This is an alternate world that you and your friends can dive into and use your imagination to experience something that's different than your boring, you know, early 1980s high school with all the jocks and social hierarchies and all of that.
Yeah.
And I think it just resonates because we are very drawn to magic. And we're drawn to magic, I think, first and foremost, in the fantasy version of it.
Right.
I think there's very few people that are young children and they're like, I want to go to the back of a New Age bookstore and participate in like a Wicca ceremony with a bunch of middle-aged women. Like, that's my dream. Like, I think we love the idea of this fantasy magic that's so exciting, of like casting fireballs and having these powers. And then I think when you get drawn into that, that can lead a lot of us into, okay, well, what's quote unquote real magic? What is the occult? How do I do magic rituals?
Right.
And you and I both know that even your very successful magic in that regard is very unlikely to like turn someone into a toad or cast a literal fireball. But I think that idea is still there. And I bet in the heart of every practicing magician, there is still a child that has that fantasy of being a real proper wizard that can teleport and travel to astral planes and do all of that kind of fun stuff.
100%. No, that's... People are deluding themselves when nobody just becomes a wizard or a magician or a warlock or a witch just because one day they went, that sounds okay to do. It grows. It grows from everything that when you were growing up, I didn't really play tabletop role-playing games. I didn't have very many friends for one, but no, it was, if there was a computer game, I was always the necromancer. Like I always chose them. And so it's like, it's just what I do. So I hear exactly what you're saying.
I remember as a kid, there was like where the grocery store was when I was growing up in Indiana, there was a store nearby that was called Fantasyland.
Okay.
And on the sign, it said toys, novelties, fantasy arcade. And I was like, oh my God, Mom, I want to go in that store. Like I'm imagining an arcade with arcade cabinets that are all like, you know, Dungeons and Dragons, Lord of the Rings games.
Right.
No, that's a porn store. Obviously a porn store. But I just remember the signage. I was like, this is everything I want. You have toys? You have a fantasy arcade? That is the coolest thing I've ever heard of.
What magic is this indeed? I think that's the first time I've ever done that on a podcast where I've actually... Anyways, terrible. Moving on. So what exactly made somebody a wizard? Was it just being a smart dude back in the day? Was it just, hey, I know 5 of the 7 liberal arts, so I'm good to go? What, from your understandings as far as the history of people that were considered what we would now call wizards, what was it that made them so?
I'm going to introduce an idea that will bring us around to that. But so let's imagine drawing a circle, right? You've got a circle and you're inside of that circle and that's everything that you know.
Yeah.
Now, somebody draws a wider circle and they can move in that wider circle, but you only know the smaller circle. Now, that person can move out of the circle that you know, move into that wider circle and appear on the other side. And you're like, how did you do that? I have no idea that that wider circle exists. Like,
right.
I saw you leave the world that I know and come in someplace else. That's mind blowing. And so that's the trick of stage magic. Stage magic is I have spent thousands of hours learning how to keep a card pressed to the roof of my mouth and have a normal conversation for 25 minutes and then pull this thing out. That didn't exist in your circle.
Right.
You never thought for a moment that I had a card stuck to the roof of my mouth this whole time. So it appears magical to you because it's outside of the context with which you understand.
Right.
Now, if we go into a hypothetical archetypal medieval village, your average person has a pretty small circle. They don't understand all that much about the world. They've never read a book. They're illiterate. And so their understanding of the world is pretty confined.
Right.
So if they encounter somebody who is learned and has a much wider circle, whether that's just knowing how to use the herbs that grow in the woods outside of the village, or because they're studying, you know, alchemy from Arabic texts, and they know how to use saltpeter to make an explosion, that is going to appear as magic for you because you have nothing in your circle of context that allows you to understand what that is. So I think that when we think about wizardry, we still use this term, like, you know, an engineer, a computer wizard is like, I can't figure out how to log into my email. You were able to fix my computer. You stepped outside of my circle of knowledge and did something that blows my mind. I don't know how you did it. You're a wizard. I'm just going to kind of write that off as your magic. And so I think when you have this medieval world where almost in the same way that we have these wealth gaps today that are incredibly unequal, you had a knowledge gap that was incredibly unequal. And so for the average populace where everyone was illiterate. I mean, literacy only really expanded to the general populace in the last couple hundred years.
Yeah.
People that knew this information, that had a wider view of the world, of history, of science, of magic, of philosophy, I mean, they're wizards. They can do stuff that we can't even begin to imagine. That's insane.
Yeah. And even sometimes, because I like the example that you used as far as somebody who's involved with technology, sometimes it's not even that they're more learned. They might just know a simple trick or two. Like your tech wizard is basically going to tell you to unplug and replug your modem back in to fix your internet. Back in the day, if you knew one or two simple tricks, you're a wizard.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, an auto mechanic is a wizard if you don't know how to fix a car.
Yes, exactly. So I do have to ask this, though. Why do you think that wizard, which we tend to think of in a somewhat fond way, they're usually male, whereas witch, which we tend to think of in a somewhat negative way, is female? Why do you think that this is?
I'm sure it's historical sexism of there was one image that we had of men who were studying in books and learning these things, and then another that we had of women that were midwives and, or I mean, you know, honestly, like, I mean, most of the historical witch accusations were false. It was just a lot of finger pointing and hysteria. So I think, you know, there's plenty of information out there about how the witch was used to demonize feminine independence and all of that kind of stuff. And I think Gandalf was also a man. Like, I think that's, you know, the fictional wizard that we were introduced to has been traditionally a male-bodied person. But, and I think we'll get into this in a little bit, but I am really trying to dismantle that. I have a very paradoxical task, which is, you know, where wizards live. We love paradox. But I am embodying, as a white, bearded, pointed hat person, I am embodying the very literal, common, gendered representation of wizard, but I am doing everything I can to try and promote the idea that you don't have to be a man to be a wizard. And I hate the idea that boys are wizards, girls are witches, because I think witch and wizard are completely different concepts. And there's so many more male witches out there now, but I think wizard, it's a very different idea. And I'll give you the example that I like to use of a female wizard. I think Mary Poppins is a female wizard.
Yep.
Mary Poppins strolls in, and the father, the banker, is totally against the idea of her being the nanny. And then she convinces him that it was his idea to hire her. She doesn't persuade him just to, you know, here's why I should be. She makes him think it was his idea. So that's a little bit of headology, mind magic, that I think is very wizardry, wordplay, cleverness. And then the first thing she does with the kids is she says, hey, chores suck, right? Everybody hates doing chores. But if you make a game out of chores, then it becomes fun. So you can shift your own perspective. You're doing the same action, but a spoonful of sugar makes the medicine go down. Right. And so then she is constantly using, you know, the barbarous names of supercalifragilisticexpialidocious and constantly talking about imagination and journeying into these imaginary worlds and blurring that line. And she is there to help that family get together. And once her work is done, she flies off with her umbrella. And I think that's another important thing, is that the wizard is not the hero. The wizard, in like the, you know, classic Joseph Campbell sense, is the guardian of the threshold, who is there to help the hero, to give them the magical aid that they need, that they don't understand. They're like, why did that guy give me a stick? That's not going to be useful. And then, of course, when they're fighting the monster, they're like, the monster's weakness is exactly the same shape as the stick that I have. Like, this is great.
Right.
And so I think Mary Poppins is a really great example of, she's not a witch. She has magic, but she's not out in the backyard making the kids dance under the full moon and grinding herbs and, you know, practicing witchcraft as we know it.
Right.
It's a lot more about sort of meta context, wordplay, perspective shifting, that kind of magic, which I think is the heart of wizardry.
I love it. That's a really great example, Devin. Now, would you say that wizard is mainly a fictional construct? Because I'm going to get into it a little bit later, but I was trying to hit you, like, I want to talk about some of the lore that came up with something like Merlin. And you said, like, I'm more interested in the idea of the wizard. And so this, to me, in some way, speaks to the more fictional aspects of what a wizard is. Not to say that it's untrue. Of course, subjective and objective, to me, they exist on a spectrum in some way. But wizard itself, do we need works of fiction and tales for a wizard to be a thing?
That's a great question. I think it's a spectrum. And like we were talking about with Wicca, like Wicca is a fictional religion. I mean, I'm not trying to insult anyone that practices Wicca. I'm a wizard. I'm a fictional character. So please, like, do not take offense to this. But we know that the story that started the witch religion of Wicca that Gardner came up with is not accurate historically.
Right.
And at this point, if you want to practice magic, you have options. You can say, you know what? I think the Llewellyn books about this idea of Wicca and witchcraft appeal to me. They make more sense to me and they give me more juice to work with in my magical practice. And somebody else says, I would actually rather read historical accounts of the Salem witch trials and get down to the factual history of it. And that's what I'm interested in. Both are, in a sense, different degrees of fiction. History is stories that we're telling ourselves about the past. A history is always edited. It's always been altered in some way. And a fiction is always based in some form of reality. You can't have a fiction that has no relationship to our human experience in the world, or otherwise it would make no sense to us. And so it's, again, it's on that spectrum. So I think Wizard comes out of the soil of history. There were real people that probably called themselves wizards, that did things that were amazing, that were interested in magic, and that idea grows in the European cultural consciousness as, or I mean, even more specifically, the English one, because it's an English word, although there was magic people elsewhere, but like that English word of wizard grows up and then takes on a new life in fiction, and now is this thing that we know and is continuing to evolve into the 21st century, of which I am a part of that transmission. Someone, you know, hopefully could look back from the 22nd century and be saying, ah, yes, you know, let's talk about John Dee, J.R.R. Tolkien, and Devin Person as these different evolutions in like the wizard as a cultural artifact.
Right.
So I think it really comes down to, how do you want to approach that topic? Mm-hmm. You know, somebody might like to watch History Channel documentaries about World War II. Somebody else might like to read original source material or academic books on it. You know, it's all about what kind of flavor you want. And so I think the historical roots are really interesting. I'm excited to hear you share some of your wisdom about it, because that's a area outside of my research, because I've been much more interested in the 20th century and how, you know, a legend like Merlin is constantly evolving.
Yep.
And it was evolving and shape-shifting throughout the history that you're probably going to give us. But then it hits these milestones, and there's something like Merlin as presented in Sword in the Stone,
right,
which I saw as a kid. That's embedded deep in my consciousness. For a lot of people of my generation, that's kind of what they're thinking about when they think wizard and that archetype flashes in their brain. They're probably not thinking about Geoffrey Monmouth or something, you know, like,
right.
I don't think as many kids were reading that at bedtime.
No, for
but,
sure.
I know that this is an area of your interest in the wizard, and I'd love to hear more about my roots that I don't know about. It's like a genealogy.
Yeah.
Ancestry.com.
Well, I love to go back to what you were saying. Do like what you had to say there, particularly with the idea of, say, something like Wicca. It goes to a book that I'm incredibly fond of called Apocalyptic Witchcraft by Peter Gray. He has a list of like the commandments, his witchcraft, apocalyptic witchcraft commandments. And one of them is that a witchcraft is one of those things where it doesn't confuse myth for history, but uses myth to create a new future. And I think that that is something that is incredibly important, at least of all the things that Peter listed. That is the one that has always stuck with me.
I love that.
Yeah, because I see a lot of people that are confusing myth for history, not to throw shade at anybody. Myth is great. I mean, if we don't have myth, we don't have everything that makes us what we are, particularly for people that are magicians, right? But to take something like myth and to be able to create something of your own is indeed incredibly crucial. We do have to get into it. We do not have our conceptions of wizards without Merlin, in my opinion. I don't know if you'd agree, Devin, but
I would agree.
Merlin is basically, and there's another figure who I will talk about who's more like the roots, but Merlin is pretty much the trunk of the tree from which all of our conceptions of wizards come. As many branches.
And it gets turned into a tree, right?
Yeah.
So there you go.
So I'm going to talk a little bit about Merlin. So Merlin gets confusing, and there could literally be a whole series of episodes about Merlin. There's endless debates, but we're pretty much settled on Geoffrey of Monmouth, who was a British cleric involved in the 11th century version of what we would call historiography. So there's many sources for what we think where this idea of Merlin came from. But it looks like for what we would consider sword and sorcery tales within a Western context, most of them, they come from the Welsh. bless the Welsh and bless Wales, because their stories are hardcore and they're awesome. Again, thank you, Wales. You have a bit of Welsh ancestry, do you not?
Yes. So I won't reveal my actual I legally changed my name when I became a wizard. So okay. My name is now Devin Middle Name Person. I'm a legally recognized fictional entity. But my family name, I remember when I was a kid, I had an assignment where it was like, look up in the dictionary, like ask your parents where they're from and then look that up in the dictionary. Right. And my dad was out of town, but my mom was like, I think his family is Welsh. And we went and looked up Welsh in the dictionary, and there was a description basically of my dad, just like of his features. And so at some point, someone in the family did some genealogy, and my family was actually from an area that was on the river across from Wales. So like just okay. across the river from Wales. And at the point when these are like, you know, Anglo-Saxon tribes,
right.
there was a 10x10 hill, or I guess maybe even earlier, there was a 10x10 hill where people would meet. And my family was from that area. And eventually they became the Tintin Hills. And eventually that morphed into the name that I won't share. Okay. But that's the legacy that I know of the Welsh roots.
It's in your blood, man. It's
in my blood.
It's awesome. It's
but you don't have to have a proper ethnic blood to do this. No,
absolutely
practice.
Not. Mostly, it is mostly agreed upon that Merlin came from Merlin Wilt, who was a legendary figure. Now, he could have been based on many other figures. Merlin was a prophet as well as a madman. He would talk to animals. He favored the company of animals over human. In earlier tales, he is certainly less wizardy than we would expect. But Joffrey, the earliest surviving work of his is something called Prophetae Merlinae, which means the prophecies of Merlin. And one of the prophecies was one of, and you can look up, there's art. There's really great medieval art of this, of two dragons fighting. One is red, which is British, and one is white, which is the Saxons. And if you don't know what the Saxons are, you should probably do a bit of research and go into some history. Have you heard of this? Have you seen this, the image of these two dragons fighting, Devin?
No, I haven't.
No, okay. I'll put some show notes up, but it's very interesting. I think there's one picture in particular because it was used in like school texts and all of this kind of thing, but it's quite renowned of two dragons in a pit and they're fighting. One's red and one's white, but this comes from Geoffrey of Monmouth. Yes, he said that the white dragon would win. So the first document into which Myrdin was changed into Merlin came from Prophetae Merlinae. Right after this, his next work was called Historia Regum Britanniae. I hope I'm saying that right. But Merlin gets more stories added, and he also goes to the more earlier sources, and he just builds on these ideas of prophecy from his earlier work as well. So Merlin, the original concepts of what we would call wizard, was more of somebody who was able to see the future, which is really quite interesting to me. In this one also, his name, Merlin, becomes Merlin Ambrosius. There's interesting stuff in this tale. Apparently, Merlin created Stonehenge. It's not very Arthurian at this point. Yeah, but then again, Geoffrey creates a third work called Vita Merlinae, and there's some really strange stories in this one. Look it up on Wikipedia if it's interesting. But people, they keep building from Geoffrey's work, adding their own flourishes, their own brushstrokes. There's one story by Robert de Baron called Merlin. It's a poem. And from this we get the sword and the stone. It literally ends, this poem ends with the sword and the stone. The idea of Merlin telling that the next king of England, or the next king, will be the person that was able to take out the sword and the stone. And we would consider that like the start of Arthur's story, but in this poem, yeah, it's like, that's the end. What happens afterwards? Who knows? But very cool stuff and definitely worth reading.
It's almost like King Arthur is then a spinoff of that.
Yeah.
Of that story.
Very much so. Well, a lot of Arthur was kind of like on a separate track, and they just kind of got blended as stories.
It's like fan fiction almost, like where it's like, exactly. Oh, hey, like we've got this one character over here and this other, you know, Merlin and Arthur team up.
I'm going to get into that in a second, because there's a really interesting document that I think if Merlin's interesting, everybody needs to read it. Before that document, though, the story, it gets building, and it comes into something called the Vulgate Cycle, which, cool name. I could do a full episode on the Vulgate cycle. There's a Vulgate cycle. There's a post-Vulgate cycle. It's incredible stuff, and it's very, very complex, and people argue about it constantly. People take this stuff incredibly, incredibly seriously. But in the 13th century, there was something called Of Arthur and Merlin. This is where a lot of the things get, as I was saying, the two tracks, they get solidified far, far more quickly. And in this one, the idea of Merlin, it's also pretty heavy. Merlin is basically the son of a rape. The devil raped a very pious woman, and her offspring was Merlin, the one who was able to tell the future. So that's not included in too many Disney cartoons.
They tend to cut that out.
Yeah, but finally we have Thomas Malory. Now, little is known about this guy. It is said that he wrote his book, La Mort d'Arthur, while he was in prison. He was called like a knight prisoner, which is, people have been debating what that is as well. La Mort d'Arthur is pretty much where most of our Arthurian legends, they come from this. It was hugely influential on people like J.R.R. Tolkien, everybody afterward. This is like, in English, the book from which everything from Merlin comes. But Merlin, he's only pretty much, I could be wrong, it's been years since I read it, but Merlin is pretty much only in, I think there's four books, he's only kind of in the first one. And then it goes into Knights of the Round Table, like all the stuff that we really, really know. We'd like to think that Merlin was one of those figures who's always been there. He's always by the side of Arthur, but in La Mort d'Arthur, he's kind of just in the first book, and then he ducks out. Peace! He's just gone. Yeah. But Merlin, he remains mysterious through all of these earlier stories. He's a bit of a bit player in some ways. He's not as powerful as somebody like Gandalf. Prophecies was his thing. I love these documents, these older documents, because they give us a look into the past. And I know that sounds like really a simple thing to say, but Merlin's motives, they're really unclear. Ben, perhaps if you were living back in that time, you'd be like, that makes sense. But to us now, it's really hard to take apart. But it is safe to say that Merlin is pretty much the wizard of wizards, I think, and has been for over 800 years. He hasn't stopped. People keep building on his stories. And it's one of those things where Merlin is basically all of our stories of wizards come from things as crazy as the movie Excalibur, which Merlin's pretty cool in that one.
With this little skull cap.
Yeah.
Little, like, metal skull cap.
Exactly. Two things like that you're a huge fan of, the Disney film The Sword and the Stone, which I haven't watched in years. I used to work at a video store, and in the mornings when people would come in with their kids to rent videos, I could only put on, you know, kid cartoons. I would usually put that on or Robin Hood. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, like, he's pretty, he's like a chum. He's like Arthur's chum. He's God.
In The Sword and the Stone, which is based off of, I'm trying to remember the author of the book that wrote The Once and Future King and all of those.
Right.
But it's something like T.S. Eliot, but it's obviously not T.S. Eliot, but I'm forgetting it right now, but you'll fix it in the show notes. Yeah. But anyways, yeah. So Merlin is waiting for Arthur to appear, Wart, as he's known in the story.
Right.
And so he has that prophecy. He can see the future. He has, you know, he knows about steam and modern technology and things like that. And then when Arthur arrives, Merlin's job is to teach him. And right. Then the rest of the film is him teaching him, not just by making him memorize stuff, but teaching him through the wisdom of experience by transforming him into various animals and going on adventures.
Yeah.
And that all leads up to the moment when, of course, Wart pulls the sword from the stone and then becomes King Arthur, which before that happens, he gets in a fight with Merlin, and Merlin says, well, screw this, screw you. I don't like, you got a bad attitude, kid. And
right.
He goes off to Bermuda in the future, which is another very important part of wizardry. Is like, the wizard doesn't fight the hero's battles for him. The wizard is always like Yoda fades away when Luke's like, no, I need you to help me with Darth Vader.
Peace, I'm out.
You know, not going to spoil anything, but you know, Dumbledore's not really there when Harry has to fight Voldemort.
Right.
I could give you, I mean, even the Wizard of Oz, Dorothy's like, ah, you're finally going to help me. And he floats away in the balloon. Right. And that's when Dorothy realizes the ruby slippers were on her feet the whole time.
Right.
So yeah, Merlin is great in The Sword and the Stone because he has magic. He can see the future. He's very much a magical wizard, but he's also eccentric and discombobulated and disorganized and kind of like doesn't have his shit together, which I think is very important. I think like the wizard is not a figure who is always right and is always perfectly able to handle every situation. Yeah. They kind of, it's like a Jackie Chan fight scene where they're sort of frantically scrambling the whole time, but then it all sort of works out and they get a lot of lucky breaks and they're like, ah, yes, I meant to step on that rake and then knock that thing over and kill all those guys. Great, that worked out perfect.
Totally going to divert here. What's the name of the song? Is it Higgity Fidgety?
Higgity Fidgety, yeah, when he's packing his bag. Yeah. Yeah, and, that's a great one.
And his poor owl, Archimedes?
Archimedes is the owl. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Nailed it. I'm proud of myself.
And I mean, you can find a gif of that easily of him shrinking all the books into bag, which I think is probably very true to both of our hearts. Like anytime I go on a trip, I'm like, I'm going to be gone for 2 days. I should probably bring 5 books.
Absolutely.
Before we get back on track, I just wanted to say, I think I miss this piece earlier, but you really brought it so clearly that when people are asking, where does wizard come from? And we have these modern fictional wizards, and then we're trying to trace them back to like a figure like John Dee, a historical wizard. We're actually missing the fact that before that, we have all of these legends, which are fiction, about Merlin, which were in the cultural consciousness of European people. And that is why when they saw somebody who was like a royal astronomer, they're like, like Merlin, right? Wizard. Got it. Absolutely. And so I think, it's this alternating of fact and fiction that's really blending them together.
Yeah. Well, Historia Regum Britanniae, it was written as that's the history of Britain, right? So those who could read, Merlin was real, right?
Yep.
Incredible, incredible stuff. But let's not to say that it's not real, but let's talk a little bit about fictional wizards, because I think this is where most of us, that's where our ideas. John Dee is familiar to you, to I, but if I was to say the name John Dee to anybody on the street, they'd have no idea. If I say Merlin and Gandalf, they go, bingo.
I was walking in Brooklyn once, and I turned a corner and I was in my wizard robes, and this older Hispanic lady just stopped and her face lit up with the biggest smile.
Awesome.
And she clutched her chest and she goes, it's a Merlin.
Yes. Yeah, if you were to say no, my dear, I'm John Dee.
What a pedantic asshole that person would be. I was very happy to be like, yes, I'm Merlin. And then I gave her a hug and she was very happy.
Awesome. Now, there's Merlin. We've got Gandalf. I love, the history of Gandalf and how Tolkien, I could do 15 episodes about the Lord of the Rings. It's my favorite thing in the world. And this is the episode where I talk about the Astari, let's talk a little bit about fictional wizards and who are some of your, besides something like Merlin or Gandalf, who are some of your favorites? Who do you think is up there amongst the great wizards?
Sure. So I think we've barely touched on it so far, but I think we have to acknowledge the presence of Harry Potter.
Yeah.
For a generation, that is their Beatles. Their memories were going to wait outside of bookstores. It's a huge thing. And not just in terms of one-way consumption, but in terms of all of the fan fiction and the people that started Quidditch clubs at their college. This is something that where people really took a magical world as something that gave the real world structure and meaning. Yes, Harry Potter is a wizard, but I think the real wizard in those stories is Dumbledore.
Yeah.
Dumbledore is the archetypal wizard. And I like Dumbledore a lot because he is very benevolent and very helpful, but also having fun.
Yeah.
Dumbledore seems like he's having a good time, even when everybody's all in a Twitter about some, oh no, Voldemort's coming. He's kind of he knows how it's going to go. He's very serene. He's very zen about things. He's very playful. He always gives a wink and a joke more than a straight answer. So I like Dumbledore quite a bit.
Yeah.
And I also grew up reading the Wizard of Oz books by Frank L. Baum. And
they're great
and later
books.
Authors.
They're really
they're,
wonderful
they're
books.
They're great books. They're I think everyone knows the movie now, the movie that we know as the Wizard of Oz was the fifth film version of the Wizard of Oz.
Correct.
So they were already into remakes way before, way before the modern era. And the original books are so good, and it's such
dark.
A charming fantasy world, but everyone's so polite. Characters are like,
yeah,
hello, are you a talking horse? I am a talking horse. Oh, would you like to go on an adventure? And I think the wizard, though, is a very important thing. This is one where actually this moment in the film more than the book. But in the film, when he gives the awards to everybody at the end, I think that is such a beautiful symbol of how he's giving the diploma to the scarecrow who doesn't think he has brains. He's given the medal of courage to the lion. He's giving the heart to the tin man. And this is all trickery.
Yeah.
These are all things that are meaningless. Yeah. You know, a medal only means something because we agree it means something. A diploma only means something because we say, do you have a diploma? Then you can get this job. And so he's using these arbitrary icons to help these characters realize it was in them the whole time.
Yeah.
And he is a phony. Mm-hmm. I think that's the most important part. He's a charlatan. He is literally like, you know, a P.T. Barnum style con man who arrived in a magical world and said, OK, I think I've got an angle here and I'm going to go with it. And so he's in a world that has real magic. It has powerful evil witches. And he has set himself up as an emperor because he knows how to do showmanship. And I think that is a very important thing that, you know, when I started on my journey to become a wizard, I realized from the beginning that if I convinced myself I was a wizard, but no one else, that would not be good.
Right.
I could convince myself, this is, you know, we talked about magic and mental health a little bit. If I was convinced that I was fighting dragons and slaying demons and ascending through the tree of life to attain holy gnosis with my guardian angel, but everyone else saw me as somebody who was drooling on himself on the subway, that's a bad time. I don't want that. My wizardry only works when someone says, hey, do you know Devin? You mean the wizard? Hey, I know a wizard. That guy's a wizard. I mean, the New York Times wrote an article. They said I'm a wizard. Like now, you know, someone can disagree and say, I don't think you're really a wizard. But there's a lot more people that agree, which is very similar, I think, to the Wizard of Oz approach of saying, how do you use your reputation and showmanship and iconography to be larger than you are as an individual human being? And how can you use that in a way that is also still, I think, good? I mean, I don't think the Wizard of Oz is a perfect character. I don't think he's like completely, you know, there's some dubiousness to what he did.
Yeah.
But I think it's very important to acknowledge that it's okay for something to be fake and meaningful at the same time. Like it can be total bullshit and very powerful and true. And that's a contradiction I'm happy to embrace.
Absolutely. To go back to something you said earlier, as much as everybody loves Dumbledore, I was literally thinking of this last night before going to bed, because this is just, my podcast is basically my life. Earlier conceptions of Merlin, they seem, and I haven't read the books, I was too busy reading other things. I'm a little bit older than people that were reading Harry Potter when it first came out, but I've seen several of the movies. Early Merlin is more like Snape than he is. He's just, you don't know where to place him. He seems, is he evil? Is he like, that's a weird one. He knows something that, I'm not going to spoil things for anybody, but he knows things and you're not too sure of what he's trying to do.
Even the John Borman Excalibur film. Yeah. Merlin's kind of a dick and he's like blowing in and out at various points, but he's definitely not the, you know, kindly, just like happy to serve you, King Arthur.
Exactly.
And I think that's the same thing with Gandalf.
Yeah.
Like you touched on the Astari and that, but like Gandalf is in that wider context. Mm-hmm. When Bilbo's like, hey, I found a magic ring. Gandalf is like, yeah, I know a lot more about that ring than you could even begin to imagine. And Gandalf is playing not four-dimensional chess, but he's part of a wider game that the characters in the story aren't aware of. And there's some really funny moments in the books where they're sort of like, Gandalf, like, where have you been? And he's like, wizard business.
I've got it. Yeah.
Like, my life doesn't revolve around like hanging out in the Shire with you. Like, I'm friends with you. I'm going to stop by, but like, I've got other stuff to do. And they're like in the middle of a quest. And they're like, where are you going? He's like, again, I have other stuff to do. Like, this is not the only thing that I'm working on, guys.
I'm just going to nerd out for a second here, but
oh, please.
I love the fact that when people try to be like, well, why didn't just Gandalf take the ring and do his thing? He's like an all-powerful wizard. It's like, No, 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 no. Gandalf fucks things up. Like, Gandalf doesn't always get stuff right. And so it's like he knows that he can't take the ring. And anyways,
and the wizard is not the hero.
No.
The wizard is not the hero. If you get anything from this episode, the wizard is not the hero. And if you're looking at these stories, it's really, I mean, there are wizards who are heroes, but it's really important to think about that role as how are you guiding others and how are you helping others to achieve fulfillment in their quest. And you are a very poor teacher if you shove someone out of the way and say, here, let me just fill in the right answers for you. There you go.
Right.
Your homework's finished. Great.
Yeah.
No one learns anything that way.
No. There's other great examples. I don't, we can't go into every single one of them.
Who's your favorite that we haven't talked about?
You know what? It's definitely going to be Gandalf. And so we've kind of already talked about Gandalf is incredible, but I would say like the one that has always been with me and I'm slowly trying to erase in my, we'll have to have you back on, Devin. We'll just go into, we'll just have the show on Gandalf because
yes, I
because I know far too much about Gandalf than I should. But I think the one from the very beginning, and it's, I'm glad that you wrote about it because it really didn't come into my mind, is Yoda. Yoda is without a doubt my favorite character in Star Wars.
I love
everything about Yoda. I remember. I'm not making this up. I remember sitting on my parents' bed in Calgary, Alberta. I would have been 4 or 5, sitting on their bed watching The Empire Strikes Back for the first time and being crushed that this mythical Jedi was this horrible goblin. I was so upset because... So he's only talked about for about, you know, once. You're going to meet a great Jedi. And in that 30 minutes before who Yoda is actually revealed, already in my young 5-year-old mind, I'm picturing this robed figure, like 7 feet tall.
Yeah.
Lightsabers coming. And I was crushed. Yeah. When it's this little goblin thing.
Little swamp rat.
But even for a 5-year-old mind, what he says is so endearing and awesome and almost just that trickster as well. Like, I'm not afraid. You will be. You absolutely will be. That really goes to a wizard archetype. And so I think that of all the wizards, I mean, I didn't read Lord of the Rings until I was maybe 8 or 9 or 10. I didn't understand half of what was going on. But Yoda's been there since the very beginning. So I'm really glad that you brought Yoda up because, yeah, that's maybe my favorite. I just love Yoda. And again, I'm trying to erase the prequels and everything that occurred before then because he's just such an incredible character.
I have a lecture that I gave that's available on my website called What Me Wizard, where I kind of explain my understanding of the wizard archetype through 5 fictional wizards. And Yoda was one of them that was really important because it illustrates a lot of these points. But I think in the relationship between Yoda and Luke, you really see the sort of like young apprentice, old master dynamic in play.
Absolutely.
And I see this all the time with the people that get excited about magic and they're like, I want the power. Tell me how to do it. Blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, hey, man. Magic's the friends you make along the way. And they get so enraged and they're like, but I swear to you, eventually you come around to that perspective. The more that you do magic, you realize that it's not about just attaining this like theoretical hyper state of power that you're questing after. It's really about how does this enrich your life and how do you have fun with it and how does it bring you joy?
Absolutely.
And I think Yoda is having a good time. Like he's like, Luke's like, teach me the secrets. He's like, no, snacks first.
That's right.
Like, he's like, don't worry, you have plenty of time. Also, I'm going to die right before you need me, but like, no big deal. Do you know about the origin of Yoda?
It's, well, as far as like how he looks.
No, about where George, I don't know how apocryphal this is, but so have you seen the Source Family documentary?
Oh, yes, yeah.
So Father Yod was running the health food restaurant, the Source, in California,
right,
that George Lucas frequented. And people have speculated that Father Yod was inspiration for Yoda.
Could be.
Yeah.
That's kind of spooky, actually.
Yeah.
If anybody knows about the Source, that's crazy. Yeah, no, I know the way that Yoda looks is literally the guy who created the monsters. He just basically made his face, and he's got his face is somewhat squished, and they just put big ears on him, and and now everybody knows about Yoda. But the source,
the source is one of those. I love that documentary because they do such a good job of, they have interviews with people who are saying this was a creepy cult, this was super predatory, this was bad, and other people who are like, I know this sounds crazy, but I saw this man perform magic. I saw true miracles occur. Yeah. And I think it's probably both. And I think that's what's so fascinating about it to me.
Absolutely. Let's talk about real wizards then.
Let's talk about real wizards, man.
I love it. So let's do a bit of a back and a forth. So why don't, Devin, why don't you share a real life wizard that you think is pretty cool and everybody needs to know, and then I'll share one. And we'll do this about three times. But give us, who do you think is a real wizard that is deserving of attention?
Sure. So this was a fun one, but I went with Helena Blavatsky because I think she is very similar to what I was talking about with the Wizard of Oz. She's kind of a charlatan in a lot of ways. She has a very dubious backstory that she proposed about, this is where I was, and I traveled around meeting ancient masters, and people are like, I think you were in Europe that whole time. I don't actually think that was true. And so I was thinking that, like, you know, the theme of this episode is very much the line between fact and fiction and how that blurs and how it's useful to blur it, which I think is very true to wizardry. Yeah. And so if someone wants to have this sort of debunker attitude, they come in, they see a character, and they're like, this is a charlatan. This is somebody who is a fake and is claiming things that are not true, and there is no hidden master, and this is nonsense. The end. I've debunked it. Go away.
Right.
But there is so much awesome stuff that came out of Theosophy. Yeah. And honestly, the New Age scene and the occult scene in the 20th century would be nothing like we recognize them as they are today without Theosophy.
Yeah,
it is so influential. And I think, you know, the second stuff that they did, where like her and I'm going to forget her colleague's name.
Alcott.
That's right. Louisa May Alcott. but no, her and Alcott, when they traveled around, I mean, they were initiated into Buddhism. I think they had a very sincere relationship with these Eastern religions and are even, you know, in those communities, like, you know, their presence in India is a whole different story. Yeah. And the way that they influence Indian culture. And even, I think, is it Ceylon? I forget where it is, but there's some place that has, like, you know, Alcott Day, because he was such an important figure in that community. Yeah. And so I think she is a great example of, one, yes, the ideas that she is bringing into this world about magic and bridging the gap between spiritualism and Eastern religion and coming up with something that's kind of a mix but new and different, but also the way in which someone can be flawed and lying and still be interesting and of value. I don't think you have to just say, I fact-checked it, I found one thing wrong, throw it maybe out the bathwater. I think she's a great example of someone who lived a very interesting life, did amazing work. And, you know, I think there probably is a lot of sexism and double standard there of the way that Aleister Crowley is held up as this paragon of the 20th century occult figure, which I'm sure you've got some opinions on, Douglas.
Yeah.
But people, like, you know, there's so many Crowley apologists. We're willing to overlook so much of his stuff.
Yeah.
I do not see the same attitude of people in the occult community around Theosophy. I don't see the same respect and acknowledgement of the contributions that Blavatsky made.
I absolutely love Blavatsky. And I mean, not in what she put forth practically, but I think she's just an incredible story. She gave so many people actual true hope compared to, say, a figure like Crowley, who just wanted your money. Anyways, but no, Blavatsky also, I think more than anything, she wanted everybody to think of her as, like, literally a wizard. Everybody's like, I need you to believe how crazy mysterious I am. But even on top of that, weird shit happened. We have notes from people that said, like, crazy things happen when she's in a room. Like, and there is some stuff that was definitely some tomfoolery. But earlier, when she first started making rounds, there's things that she did that people are still to this day like, it happened. There's no explanation for it. So
And Alejandro Jodorowsky has done a bunch of stuff with like studying the shamans and curanderas like in Mexico City. And he's got such an interesting take on it where he's like, they are using sleight of hand and magic tricks. Yeah. Like there are ways that you make blood seem to squirt out of somebody's body without cutting into them. There's ways that you make, something wriggle in a greasy bag. It's the demon that you've pulled out.
Yeah.
These are tricks.
Yeah.
But for the people who come to be healed, those tricks are part of the theater that then helps that person feel like they've gotten healed and actually have real verifiable results.
Yeah.
And I think that's a very interesting part of it that we've kind of lost, that we're like, no, if you're going to be a real wizard, you have to levitate the table, no jokes.
Yeah.
But it's like, what if I levitate the table using chicanery, but that creates an ambiance of magic that makes my ritual a lot more fun than the, just calling in the corners in the back of the bookstore.
We're breaching into new territory here, but I'm going to definitely bring this up. There's a gentleman by the name of Dr. Jack Hunter who has talked a lot about mediumship and spiritualism in his earlier work. And there are tons of notes of people who attend seances and spiritualist meetings who will go in, and the person running the seance will have very definite tricks that you can see that they're incredibly fake. And a lot of the skeptics at this point will just walk out of the seance. But for the people that stay, what occurs afterwards is incredible phantom hands forming, really incredible stuff. So I think that this idea of pretend is not good for the conversation. Perhaps a lot of this phenomena require a bit of performance for it to come through. And we're only just over the last, literally the last 30 years being like, the performative aspect might be part of allowing this phenomenon to occur.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. Like, that's the, I did it and I was trying to make it not work the whole time. So therefore it didn't work. And it's like, no, magic is trying sincerely to make it work. And if you have no skin in the game, then you haven't actually done an authentic test.
Yeah. There are reports of this one, I forget her name, but this one very particular woman who, a group of skeptics came and they watched her, and five walked out in the first 15 minutes because they were like, I can see she's holding this thing and blah, blah, blah. But for the other like 15 that stuck around, they said that ridiculously insane shit started happening that they could not explain if they were not. So sometimes you might just need a little trickery to grease that wheel, to get the medicine ball rolling. And then the magic comes through.
Sometimes you just need a giant green hologram floating head with fire shooting out of it to set the ambiance.
I love it.
All right. Give me one of your wizards, Douglas.
So my wizards, I'm just going to preface this with a three. Mine, I kind of go with not like the typical wizard, but most of these were involved in some way with an idea of monarchy, or they in some way had something to do with whoever was reigning the country at the time. So I like that aspect, that whole King Arthur Merlin thing, the once in future king kind of stuff I like about these wizards. So my very first one is a gentleman by the name of Michael Scott. He was a 12th century Scottish mathematician and scholar during his life, and after he died, he was an evil wizard. He was an incredibly smart man, like probably translated more Arabic texts into Latin than any other person of his time. He was renowned in his day. People knew about him. He served as the astrologer to Emperor Frederick II, who was King of Sicily, King of Germany, King of Italy, and the Holy Roman Empire. But before this, he was what we would consider a wandering scholar. He was that guy who would just go from town to town and just soak up as much information as he could, help some people out, and then he'd be on his way, right? Some people have said that the Fibonacci sequence, which I'm not sure if people are well aware of this, like how the sum of a number is the total of the previous two numbers, so like 2 to 3, 3 to 5, 5 to 8, 13 to 21. It is said that he might have had a hand in its conception. He was so good at math, and Fibonacci, the person who came up with it, I think he dedicated some books to Michael Scott. Anyways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they were friends.
Yeah. He was versed in everything. If there was new knowledge to be had, whether earthly or celestial, Michael was in it. He had his hands all over it. And I like Scott because he is the prime example of a guy who, like Roger Bacon and Henrik Cornelius Agrippa, that the legends after his death of being an evil sorcerer, they occur. There are stories of how when people would go to dinner with him, the plates of food would be brought in by demons and spirits. He turned a coven of witches into a stone circle. He built a church in one night with the help of demons, which is very Solomonic. He destroyed a tower of a French king by striking it with his staff, which was incredibly wizard-like. Now, all of these tales are great, and of course they all occurred after he died. But despite this, during his life, he condemns magic in his writings. He calls magic the mistress of all inequity and evil. But the thing is, in one of his books, Liber Introductorius, he includes a list of words for commanding spirits, the hours for doing so, the names of angels and their planets, and other occultish things. And so it might be because of this that he earned a spot in the eighth circle of hell in Dante's Divine Comedy. He's right there in the Divine Comedy. I love Michael Scott, not just because he's Scottish, but he has, I think, more than a lot of figures, that definite wizard vibe to him. So that's my pick, my first pick.
That's a great first pick. And it's really interesting what you said about the monarchy theme. This is not my next pick, but New Zealand has a wizard. There's the Wizard of New Zealand.
Right.
He's legally recognized. He's been on my podcast. He's a very, very interesting character. You know, he was a public speaker in this town square in Christchurch, New Zealand for years and years. So he has a lot of convoluted but very interesting philosophy that he's kind of expounded, you know, theories that he goes on. And one of them, he's British by birth, although he lives in New Zealand, and he's very into the monarchy. He thinks the monarchy is a useful fiction, and it's a very important part that, you know, it's the best system, that you should have a monarchy. Like, you know, your leaders are going to be useless, so they might as well be fun and have drama that you can follow along with.
Yeah.
For my next wizard, I'm going to go with Sun Ra.
I love Sun Ra.
And Sun Ra, for those who don't know, is a African-American jazz musician who, you know, it kind of varies of when this actually happened. Sun Ra is another character where, like, there's no complete discography. No one knows how many albums he made. It's over 100, but, like, there's no, like, and he told stories different ways, and so it gets, you know, it's hard to piece together a completely verifiable biography. But sometime in the 30s, he described having a, you know, mystical experience where he was transported to the planet Saturn, and these little aliens with antennas told him, you know, your job is to do music and to spread this word through music, and he's like, okay.
Yeah.
And so he renames himself. This is in the, you know, the 40s and 50s. He's playing jazz. He's an incredible musician. Yeah. He was very much like inspired by Leonardo da Vinci and others, and was taking cat naps and barely sleeping and just doing music all the time. So he's someone who has the skill and the rigor to actually back it up. But then he's playing jazz and getting more and more far out into this world of, you know, really, you know, he's the defining influence of Afrofuturism.
Yeah.
He is talking about, you know, black liberation. He's talking about aliens from other planets. This is before the UFO craze in the late 40s and 50s really kicked off. He was ahead of that curve of talking about there's aliens on other planets and I'm in contact with them and a mothership's going to come down and take us. And he's creating this Egyptian futuristic, magical, musical orchestra that is in some ways a cult. Like one of my favorite stories was, like, he was recruiting musicians that were not musicians. So they'd never played before because he didn't want to have all of that, you know, learned music style in his way. He wanted to teach him his way.
Get it out of here.
And they were living, I forget where it was, but they were living somewhere. And lightning struck a tree behind the house. And so he's like, cut down that tree. We're going to take that wood and we're going to make an instrument out.
Nice.
And like, that was, you know, the vibe. Like, you know, he's got a, you know, communal living, 30-person orchestra, daily rehearsals. He's a very intense, rigorous band leader.
Yeah.
But I think I was originally going to pick Moondog, who's another jazz figure that kind of did their own thing and has the classic white robe and beard. But I think Sun Ra is just a great example because he doesn't have the traditional signifiers of a wizard. He's created his own. And if you look up images of him, I mean, he has got
he's got
awesome magic style. And I think that's one of the ideas that I'm trying to bring into my wizardry, and I think is very important, is that if you have your own weird vision and you can get other people to get on board with you, if you can get other people excited about that idea can spread through you and through these other people and into the world and literally change the world.
Absolutely.
Like, we live in a different world today because of Sun Ra. And this is partially apocryphal, but one of my favorite Sun Ra stories is PBS was trying to make a documentary about him. They were like, we want to make a documentary about him. and he slowly overtook the production and changed it into being a fictional movie that he was now making that became Space is the Place,
awesome.
Which is an amazing film. It's super fun. It's like a blaxploitation, jazz, sci-fi, comedy. It's totally bonkers. And it's all about Sun Ra descending from a UFO into Oakland and announcing that he's going to take all of the black people in America to a black planet where they can do their own thing and play psychedelic free jazz and not be bothered. And it is such a fun film, and it's such a fun vision.
Yeah.
And I think in an era when black power was really coming into being, which is very important, but I think we forget about the 1960s, how militant and serious, and you know, the left was very dogmatic about things. And so I think someone who's taking that message and a spoonful of sugar makes the medicine go down, you know, is combining it with something that's fun. It's psychedelic. It's freaky.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's great. Huge fan of Sun Ra.
I mentioned him in my rock and roll and the occult episode. He has maybe one of my favorite greatest hits albums, and everybody, greatest hits albums aren't really albums. Shut up. The skill and the artistry of those songs is, I think it's two CDs. Unreal. It's so good. I love Sun Ra. So I'm so happy that you picked him, Devin.
And he's got such a funny thing. Cause like there's Sun Ra that I can't listen to. There is, you know, super squelchy, totally out there, atonal Sun Ra that I'm like not a fan of. But he also like has a kind of like a pop hit on each album in a way.
Yeah.
And there's songs like Door to the Cosmos and Space is the Place that really, they swing.
That's
what I think it was Thelonious Monk. Someone said, you know, oh, that Sun Ra guy, man, that's too far out. And he goes, yeah, but it swings.
That's right. Perfect. I absolutely adore that pick. Thank you so much, Devin. My next pick is somebody I've actually talked about already on my Alchemy episode. Her name is Mary Sidney. She was the Countess of Pembroke. She lived from 1561 to 1621. Yes, I have already talked about her, but I just want to flesh her out a little bit more because she is awesome. So some say that after Queen Elizabeth of England, obviously, this is the first, not the one that is currently alive.
How do you know they're not the same?
Some say that Mary Sidney was the most renowned woman in England. She was a lady-in-waiting, obviously, to Queen Liz. She was Sir Philip Sidney's sister. And again, if you don't know who Sir Philip Sidney is, you have to do a little bit of Google searching. I didn't know this, actually, and I just found this out before this episode. She was betrothed at the age of 13 and married at 15. Like, she was, like, picked and, like, here you go. But she did start something called the Wilton Circle, which was it was for writers and poets, but mostly poets. It was what we would consider like an art collective nowadays. They wanted English art to be a cultural phenomenon, like something of Italy, or to a lesser extent, France. But they wanted England to be important. And they said that all of the alchemical allegories in Shakespeare's work might be because of Mary Sidney, basically, and her lab assistant by the name of Adrian Gilbert, who was Sir Walter Raleigh's half-brother. Sir Walter Raleigh, of course, founded Virginia, named after the Virgin Queen, which was Queen Elizabeth. I'm going to talk a little bit about Adrian Gilbert in a second. At this house, there was a garden designed with alchemical and sacred geometry as a plan. We know for a fact that Shakespeare was a friend. We know that John Dee was familiar with Mary Sidney. And here's the one that I just found out, that most likely Giordano Bruno knew of her, or at least visited Mary Sidney at some points. He dedicated his book, Spaccio, to her brother, which was, yes, Philip Sidney. Lady Mary Wroth, the play, Ben Jonson's The Alchemist, was dedicated to Mary. I could just go on. Mary's awesome. She spoke four languages. There is debate as to who had a better library at the time, John Dee or Mary. And the more I read, the more it sounds like it might have actually been Mary. Her name comes up constantly in the debate as to whether or not Shakespeare wrote what he actually wrote, including things like his sonnets. Unfortunately, we have none of her writings on alchemy that have survived. She also has maybe one of the most badass epitaphs of all time, which is, "Underneath this sable hearse lies the subject of all verse, Sidney's sister, Pembroke's mother, death ere thou hast slain another, fair and learned and as good as she, time shall throw a dart at thee." But apparently, but apparently not, because very few people have heard of her or her work unless you're in somewhat more scholarly circles. That's changing. And there was a book of historical fiction written about her called The Imperfect Alchemist by Naomi Miller. I have not read it, but I do plan on reading it. And I just think that Mary Sidney, besides being an alchemist, I think she fits more of the wizard stereotype. She sounds like she just fostered so many people to be able to get them to create something that was seemed impossible to them at the time. And she had her fingers in so many pies. I love Mary Sidney. She's one of the best.
That's one that I was not familiar with, but it's fascinating. And I love, you know, that list of just sounds like she was throwing the coolest parties.
Yeah.
Just was kind of, you know, knew all of the people and is not the hero, but is there, you know, at the party giving, you know, you know, my friend Romeo told this story and Shakespeare's like, oh yeah, that's a good name. I should use that somewhere.
Exactly. Yes. It was basically a salon before there were salons, right? The Wilton Circle. Totally. They kind of nailed that. So yeah, that's my second pick. Who do you got, Devin?
All right. So my next one is interesting because not a beard, not a pointed cap, but was called a wizard in his time and has now lived on in legend. But Milton Erickson.
Okay.
So for people who aren't familiar, Milton Erickson is the father of modern conversational hypnosis.
Right.
So you could do a whole episode on hypnosis. The quick, you know, summary is that we can trace it back from Mesmer and this idea of animal magnetism. The term hypnosis is coined by James Braid from the Greek word for sleep. And at the beginning of the 20th century, there was a very like sort of militant style. And the idea was hypnosis is you say these things and only some people respond. Right. So we're going to study in an academic environment. We're going to have 100 people come in. The graduate student is going to read the script in a monotone voice. And some people are going to go into a trance state. Some people will not. If you did not go into a trance state, that's because you are not hypnotizable. Now, Milton Erickson had polio when he was a kid, so he was paralyzed. There's actually an incredible story about him being on his deathbed, and he could hear the doctor telling his mother that he was not going to live, and he was just focusing his, like, you know, his will on, like, I think he was staring out the window and he's like, I'm going to watch that sunrise. Like, yeah. I'm going to watch that sunrise. And he did survive, but he was paralyzed. And I think he couldn't talk for a while. So he was just observing everybody in his family, big family. And so he was seeing the ways in which what they were saying and what they were doing physically, their body, their gestures were often out of alignment, that someone would be saying, I'm very excited about this. And he's like, but their body says that they're not, like, right. there's different stories here. So when he gets interested, and he's a psychiatrist and a hypnotist, and he's seeing people, and he starts to develop a style that's very different. Instead of saying one size fits all, I'm going to give everybody the same script and it either works or it doesn't, he says everybody's unique.
Yeah.
And everybody has the resources they need to solve their problems with it. Mm-hmm. So if somebody wants to quit smoking, they already have the skill set they need to quit smoking within.
Right.
It's about accessing that resource that's buried within them, which is one of my favorite definitions of the occult, that which is hidden or obscure. So, you know, you have an occult side of you. You have things that are within you that you're not aware of, and you need to learn how to get in touch with those resources. And the way that he would do this was not just robotically recite the same script to everybody, but he famously had a very cluttered desk with a lot going on. So there's sort of like you come into his office and there's a lot to sort of get distracted. And he would start by telling you these stories that would meander and then have stories within stories and lots of these things that are called like presuppositions. And now I wonder if you've noticed the way that you're already starting to feel a little bit more relaxed, or maybe you'll notice that more in the next few minutes. And in that phrasing, I'm assuming that you're feeling relaxed. I'm not telling you feel relaxed. And so that was the old style, was like, you're getting sleepy, watch my watch, you're now in trance. And if it works, great. And if it doesn't, you're like, what's going on? But so Erickson, people would come in, he would talk to them about their problem. He would understand what their frame of reference was.
Right.
This person is talking about how she just, you know, feels so depressed because she can't see her future she used to, and it's all gone dark. And he's like, ah, this person's talking in very visual terms.
Right.
That's the language I'll use to relate. It does no good to talk to this person about feeling and listening if they're thinking in a visual way. And so he would tell a story about how, you know, his old house, he used to have his bed in this one room, but there was a big tree and the shade from the tree made it so hard to see. But he realized one day that he had the power to move his bed into another room. And in that room, the sun rose every morning and he woke up each morning feeling refreshed and could see all of the wonderful things he was going to do that day.
Right.
And so in those stories are layers of metaphor, and he would have stories within stories within stories. And so while he's talking, he's never said, now it's time for you to go to the trance. He's just talking and asking questions and positing things out loud. And then at the end of the session, he's like, okay, see you later. And the person's like, wait, what? Where did the time go? What happened?
Right.
And they've fallen into this trance. And I think that's a really incredible variation.
Yeah.
That instead of taking this kind of objective materialist, like, you know, there's one way to do it and we're just going to, you know, everybody has to fit through the same hole. He saw everybody as unique, and his job was to meet them where they were at and help them align the conscious desire that they were expressing with the things that were happening unconsciously.
Right.
Some of my favorite examples are people who had, you know, what's called hysterical paralysis, where they're like, I have this condition, I can't move my arm. I can't move my arm, it's paralyzed. And he would realize, okay, I can't just unparalyze this person's arm. They're not gonna accept that. So I'm gonna move the paralysis into their other arm.
Okay.
And so then the person is like, well, one of my arms is still paralyzed, but it's changed. So now I have to start confronting that this obviously is mental.
Right.
Like, I still have the symptom. And he would help people see these things and move in a different direction. And since he has passed, the legend has grown. And now followers of what's called Ericksonian hypnosis, it's very hagiographic. There's all kinds of stories about him just being this miracle worker.
Right.
But I think his approach is really groundbreaking. Hypnosis was something that I was interested in since I was a child. And when I actually went to an erotic hypnosis convention, which is people using hypnosis for, like, very consensually, but for like kink and stuff like that. This was early on in my journey to becoming a wizard. And I was just sitting there with my jaw on the floor the whole time saying, this is the magic I've been looking for. There's a lot of great ways to get into trance states in the occult literature.
Yeah.
And I think hypnosis is something that I really want the occult community to dive into, because it takes a lot of the veiled references and all of these other things away for a moment and lets you say, here are the techniques that we've figured out. And once you've gotten into that world of hypnosis and started to pick up on those things, you go back and you read an account of scrying and you're like, oh my God, this is eye fixation.
Yeah.
Like, hypnotists can use a candle flame, or that's the classic swinging watch.
Right.
There's so many of these parallels that I think really hypnosis is verifiable, true wizardry. Yeah. And yeah, Erickson was known as the wizard of the desert, because his success rate with clients was just completely unheard of. You know, people would come in for a few sessions and then they would leave, and then they'd say, you know what? I just don't have that problem anymore. It just went away. I kind of aligned, you know, my unconscious, my conscious, and I'm doing much better now. Thank you.
I mentioned it on the journeying episode that I had with Ren Collier. Like, my most insane out-of-body experience occurred when I was being hypnotized by my psychologist. It was quite shocking. I would agree with you 100% that I think that it is, within occult circles, it is an underutilized, or at least underappreciated aspect of what we should be looking at in this day and age towards things that we can call trance, as you say, scrying. I think that it's a direction that a lot of people should probably look into.
Yeah. And I think similar to what we were talking about earlier, the Ericksonian style of hypnosis is very different than stage hypnosis.
Right.
So if someone's like, oh, my high school did a lock-in and we had a hypnotist come. And what's interesting is the way that stage hypnosis works is it is relying on the fact that people need permission to be goofy sometimes.
Yeah.
It's like your coworker that is quiet and reserved, but they have a drink and then they're willing to go get up and sing karaoke because they have this excuse of like, I was drunk, you know, like that frees them up. And so when you create an environment where everyone's having a fun time, the audience expects you to play along with this game and have fun with it, then that frees people to really drop into this experience and to be able to do things that they would never normally do.
Yeah.
It's so weird because everyone thinks like, oh, I'm going to be hypnotized and I'm going to be blacked out. I'm not going to remember anything. I'm going to be totally unconscious. I'm going to have no will of my own. It's not like
that.
It feels very much like you're playing a game, like you're doing improv with friends, but you're very committed to the character.
Yeah.
But the results you get are fascinating. And I was doing a hypnosis salon in New York with a friend of mine when he was in college. He did like bachelorette parties and stuff.
Right.
And he had a story about these two like sorority girl types that were part of the show. They were both very good hypnotic subjects, and they were doing a game where one of them was going to speak in an alien language, and then the other one was going to translate. So this woman comes out, she now speaks an alien language, and he's like, oh my god, she's speaking a real language. Like, this is not like beep boop bop or beep boop bop. She's like, this has syntax, this has recurring words, and the other woman was speaking it back to her in the same way. They were creating a shared, like the one woman would be saying something, the other one would turn to her and then clarify a point and then translate it for the audience. Jeez. And so take that story and then think about John Dee and Edward Kelly and scrying and learning Enochian. You know, they're accessing things through the unconscious mind. Scrying is totally a hypnotic technique, and they're able to find something that has, like, you know, I mean, Enochian coming through this hypnotic channel is just a fascinating thing. And so, it's magic that's under our noses. It's one of those things that I think we're somehow like programmed to dismiss it. But if you go look at the literature on like the success rate of hypnosis helping people quit smoking and getting over other issues, it is, it is wizardry. Absolutely. It's something that we haven't figured out fully what's going on yet. So we're still kind of playing with things that we think work, but we don't have it like boiled down. And I think Erickson was a great leap forward in saying, it's more art than science. Treat it like an art. You're going to have better results.
Love it. Fantastic. Yeah. I think a lot of people need to look into hypnosis. I would agree entirely, entirely. Now, my last pick here, because we have to have a little bit of evil. Would this person cross over into warlock? Perhaps, perhaps. Remember what I mentioned earlier about Mary Sidney and her alchemical laboratory assistant, Adrian Gilbert. Well, Adrian had a brother. A very, very interesting brother. Now, I also want to say that someday someone needs to write a book about the proclivities of the near upper crust of young men within the Tudor era in England. They were sailors, a lot of them were explorers, a lot of them were soldiers, and a lot of them were wizards, and sometimes all at the same time. In fact, quite often all at the same time. So I'm going to talk about my last pick here is Humphrey Gilbert. Sir Humphrey Gilbert. That's right. I know I mentioned in the Agrippa episode that Agrippa was a knight. Well, here we have another knight wizard. Now, I can't go into the life of this dude too much. Please read his Wikipedia entry. It is insane. The guy did a ton of stuff. But I also want to also say here, the man was a cruel person. He was, by even the standards of his day, he was seen as being an evil man. He was angry all the time. The word brutal constantly comes up when people talk about Humphrey Gilbert. He was ordered by Queen Elizabeth to crush a Irish uprising in Munster. And for this, he was knighted. So yes, he was made a knight. The queen also granted him a 6-year charter to settle, in her words, heathen lands not actually possessed of any Christian prince or people. This led him at one point on August the 3rd of 1583 to land on St. John's, Newfoundland, so my home country here in Canada, and he claimed it for queen and country, obviously. So yes, Newfoundland was claimed by a wizard explorer, something that they don't teach us in school at all. He died off of the Azores Islands in a shipwreck while on a boat he was told wasn't seaworthy. So, whoops. Anyways, the reason he's here is that he is the author of what is called The Excellent Book of the Art of Magic, as well as a book called Visions. And this came out in the 1560s, or at least it was written in the 1560s. So people have to realize this was before John Dee, and they were also acquaintances as well. What is in this book is protocols to scry, as well as a record of the things that they scried. He was 28 at the time that he did this, and he had the help of another chap who was another tragic figure by the name of John Davies, who was 17 at the time. It is interesting because this is a Protestant book of magic. It's like a Protestant grimoire, and it is very different in the way that it's basically what has been called Karen magic, because they yell at the entities that they are summoning. They're really quite cruel to them. But yeah, they summon entities. Azazel is summoned. Anyways, it is an incredibly interesting, fascinating document. Roger Bacon gets summoned, King Solomon, Agrippa, and many others. If you haven't read it, it just came out, I believe, last year or the year before. It was the year before, 2019, released by Scarlet Imprint, somebody we talked about earlier, Alexander Cummins was one of the writers with Phil Lagarde. Pick it up. It's incredible. It is very, very strange, and the commentary in it is really cool. It is either an astounding, magical document just full of interesting ritual magic, or it is one of the greatest pieces of fiction written in the 16th century. Like, I am having a hard time figuring out what it is, but it exists. I am endlessly fascinated by Tudor England and Gilbert. I think that he is one of those ones who's getting a bit more attention these days. We all tend to think of, in this time period, John Dee, because even people in the day knew John Dee, who was always in the spotlight, and for good reasons. But I think Humphrey Gilbert's time has come, specifically because of the fact that I do think that he was just a crazy, cruel, strange man. And he was also last seen shouting from his ship to his companionship, "We are as near heaven by sea as by land." And then blah, 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 blah. And it went down. The moral of the story of Humphrey Gilbert is be nice to demons. That's all I'm going to say. So that's my last pick for crazy wizard warlocks. He was known as being a brutal man before he wrote the excellent book Invisions, and he remained one afterwards. And even in it's strange because most grimoires, they're somewhat Catholic-based. This is a Protestant one, and it's unlike any other grimoire. It's yelling, it's spirits, it's really being mean to them. Like, if it's, and it's very, very, very interesting document. So, yeah, I had to have, because people do like the vindictive wizard, or not vindictive, I'm going to say, like, Gilbert was, yeah, he was a piece of shit. He was really, he was really not.
He's a real Gargamel.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. Just, we're coming to the end here, but how much do you think that fictional accounts of wizards in some way obscures people's conceptions of magic and the occult, Devin?
That's a really good question, because I think, how do I describe it? It's one of those things where I don't think we would have the interest in the magic and the occult that we have currently if we didn't have these fictional characters that get us excited about
Absolutely.
It. You know, that kind of give us the vision of this awesome, wonderful, magical world that we say, yeah, I want to be a part of that. And then we go and find the more humdrum, realistic, here's actually how to do the magic. You know, you got to go get some candles and draw a circle, and you know, you're not going to actually shoot a fireball at your neighbor because you're mad at them. And so I think it obscures it because it overshadows it. Yeah. Like, you know, anyone who's a practicing magician has had that moment where someone says, yeah, well, why don't you do some magic? And then you're like, it doesn't work that way. And like, it's the lamest answer, I think.
Yes.
You know, it sucks that sleight of hand magic is such a pain in the ass to learn, because I certainly was like, man, life would be a lot easier if someone says, do some real magic. And I say, boom, fireball. And I have flash paper in my sleeve. And they're like, wow, I wasn't expecting that. But, you know, I don't want to go around like leaking kerosene into my outfit all day because I'm trying to impress that one person who's a skeptic.
Right.
So I think it both kind of overshadows it because it sets this unrealistic bar that we're all, I think, in some way after. I think there is this desire to get beyond the Wiser and Llewellyn books and find that sinister book that's bound in leather that rattles and, like, you know, have the true ascended master who can actually do things that defy reality as we know it,
right,
to have that experience. I know that when I was first starting the magic, that's what I wanted more than anything. I was like, I want to break reality and contact archons from another realm,
right,
and really prove that the world as we know it is not what it seems to be.
Yeah.
But I think the important thing is to realize that magic is about the interplay between these worlds, this physical concrete world of matter and this abstract world of ideas.
Yeah.
And as human beings, we sit precisely in the middle of that Venn diagram. And I think that's what magic is taking things from the physical world and moving them around to represent ideas and change the way that we think about things,
right,
and to take thoughts and to bring them into the world and say, this physical amulet is now imbued with the abstract idea of courage. And whenever I wear this amulet, I'm going to feel courage. And I think in terms of, you know, we can imagine a cult as it exists in the real world on one side and magic as it exists in fiction on the other. And I think that interplay is really amazing. And we're entering a new era where wizardry is all around us.
Yeah.
You and I are talking through a complicated network of technology that neither of us fully understand, and we're on the doorstep of a world in which augmented reality and all these other things are going to blend that line beyond all recognition. We've already seen, one of the jokes I like to make is, as a wizard, I take silly ideas seriously and serious ideas silliestly. Yep. And I think the danger that you get is when you mistake fact or fiction and you don't have that sort of mindful remove to have a sense of humor about it.
Right.
You know, QAnon is a problem because people are saying, hey, these convoluted synchronicities I've gotten caught up in, these are real. Right. This is real. And I think we've probably met magicians who they're having a lot of synchronicities happen and they're getting a little bit spun out and they're getting a little bit hard to talk to, and that's very uncomfortable. And so I think wizardry is the playful intersection of those where you're saying, yeah, it's true and it's not true. There is a mountain, there is no mountain. It's ridiculous, it's sublime. No one's ever gonna understand exactly what's happening. So let's have some fun with it.
Absolutely. So in your eyes,
mm-hmm.
because you call yourself a wizard.
I do, a lot. I probably said the word wizard more than most people on the planet right now.
But what about the others? What about the other people? To call oneself a wizard these days, what do you think it takes?
You mean like what does it take to call yourself a wizard?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I think to call yourself a wizard, it doesn't take anything. You can say, I'm a wizard, and nothing's, you know, as long as you can physically pronounce those words, you can call yourself whatever you want.
Right.
I think the real magic occurs when you get other people to call you a wizard. And so I think in order to do that, it helps to represent the archetype in some way. Okay. So I think the clothes make the man or woman or whatever gender you would like to be. Yeah. And so I think that it's a combination of confidently imbuing yourself with this fictional archetype, whether you want to claim that you're in touch with aliens on Saturn that told you to communicate through free jazz, or you're telling people that you're a wizard and that your podcast is a ritual.
Right.
So I think if somebody out there is into it, I would suggest really thinking about what the word wizard means to them. They want to have their own understanding. Don't take my word for it. Have your own gnosis, have your own understanding of what this means. And then think hopefully about the positive aspects of, like, how can you use the things that you are uniquely skilled at to help others? Mm-hmm. How can you decenter yourself and be of magical aid to your community? And I think a lot of people want to do that right now in this very centering way where they're like, I'm the life coach, I'm the guru, I'm the person with all the answers. And so I'm hopeful that we can start to see a new trend where people are using this idea of wizard to perform new kinds of magic that aren't just what we've had in old grimoires, but are kind of like you've talked about Alan Moore's fossil angels of like really finding new territory and new ground to cover, especially in this world where there's so much technology around us that is baffling and confusing.
Yeah.
I'm giving a convoluted answer, but I think it's about finding what resonates in that archetype with you and how you can bring that into your life in a way that feels positive and fun. Not everybody needs to wear a pointed hat and grow a beard. Right. I think people that their college experience was defined by playing on a Quidditch team that they formed with their friends. Right. That's beautiful. Yeah. You know, you're a bunch of nerds running around a field, throwing balls at each other. And that's how you formed friendships that you're going to have for the rest of your life. I think that's beautiful magic and wizardry.
I did something interesting before recording this episode, and hopefully people pick up on this, but I really want each and every person that's listening to go back into your past and look at the figures that were magical figures and see how the things that they did, how that has changed or in some way inspired you to be what you are now. I think that that is an interesting exercise for each and every person to do. I'm saying go further, go way back. Like, did the Wizard of Oz really pique your interest in something? Did Yoda, as Yoda did for me, did that make things really interesting? Were you always the paladin when you played role-playing games? Mm-hmm. Is that idea of trying to heal, to help, to assist, is that something that you have now? And if not, I'm not saying get back on the path, but realize probably where you came from and the things that influenced you is, I guess, one lesson to take from this show. The Wizard, Devin, are they going away anytime soon? Or do you think they're here to stay?
I hope not. No? I hope not. I think the 21st century. So when I decided to become a wizard, I Googled it and I didn't find anybody else that was doing this. Right. I knew they had to be out there, but I didn't find it. After I did my ritual to become a wizard, suddenly I heard about the Wizard of New Zealand, who's been doing this since the 70s. I heard about Oberon Zell, who bred actual unicorns as goats. It's a fascinating story. Okay. Oberon's a really interesting character. He's really, really influential in modern paganism. He was one of the first people to call himself a pagan, to self-refer as pagan, right. And his partner coined the term polyamory. So, you know, Oberon and the Wizard of New Zealand, I think, represent this older generation, but I get contacted more and more by people who say, hey, this is resonating with me. I'm really thinking about following this path, and I'm not trying to be... I do not have the answers. I do not have the definition. I don't want to say this is what you have to do to be a wizard. Follow my 12-step process. But I think in this new world, it's a very important tactic to constantly be thinking about those circles I mentioned at the beginning.
Yeah.
To think about where are the boundaries of your knowledge and what exists outside of that. And then think about the larger context and ask yourself one of my favorite Latin phrases, qui bono? Who benefits? Mm-hmm. There are so many things that we're told one story that is a fiction, and the fact beneath it is actually manipulation and trying to lead us to do something else.
Right.
So I think it's a very important thing, especially as social media platforms and algorithms and businesses get much, much better at finding our psychological blind spots and weaknesses and using them against us, for us to think about the world as people in a magical framework did, where human beings are not the top of the totem pole. Human beings are sort of somewhere in the middle, and there's all kinds of entities, whether they be angels and demons and deities and gods, or they be corporations and brands and social media influence campaigns and all of that. I think it's important for us to start acknowledging that there's bigger fish in the sea than we can see with our eyes, and they're trying to steer us. And the same way that a magician used to draw that magical circle of protection and lay down the law and say, okay, entity, I've got to deal with you, but I don't fucking trust you. I think when we approach these other things, we've got to say, all right, internet company, I want this thing that you're offering, but I don't fucking trust you.
No. Wonderful. I love it, Devin. This is not going to be the end of this discussion in some way. I'm going to be appearing on your show pretty soon as well. And I don't want to totally give it away, but I think it's going to be a fantastic discussion as well. So I've had so much fun, Devin. What do you got going? What's next for the wizard?
Well, so right now I'm sort of opening this new chapter. I've moved out of New York City into Louisville, Kentucky, and I actually recently hurt myself, so I'm mending from that. So it's this kind of limbo period. Yeah. But I have a podcast called This Podcast is a Ritual, and we're really kind of slightly better is a very important phrase in my magical philosophy, and we're about to make it slightly better. So we're kind of revamping the Patreon and taking it a little bit more seriously than I have in the past, and trying to grow some of these ideas in fun new ways. And then I'm working on some writing. I've been doing a lot of magic with gnomes over the last couple of years. And I think gnomes are a very good ally in terms of being benevolent, kind, playful, pranksterish spirits that have a lot of value in community and skill and growing and gardening and all of these things.
Yeah.
And if you look at the modern world and see the problem we have with internet trolls are the ancient enemy of the gnome. And so I think we need more internet gnomes, and I'm working on a grimoire of magic of how to work on that.
That's amazing. Fantastic. So yeah, I want everybody to please check out what Devin's getting up to, as well as Devin's Patreon. All of that will be in the show notes for whatmagicisthis.com, basically. So head there, show notes for Devin's stuff, and there's going to be some interesting books that I'll have up there. There's one book, I forget the author's name, but it's about Merlin as well. I read it years ago. It was wonderful. And that's basically where all my knowledge of Merlin comes from. But yes, check out the show notes, please. If you enjoy the show, please leave a review on any place that you can leave a review, basically, iTunes or Stitcher. But please do that, as well as if you enjoy the program, please tell a friend, and perhaps they'll tell a friend, and then they'll tell a friend. That's basically how I do promotion for my podcast. You can find my Twitter account, my Instagram account, as well as my Facebook account on whatmagicisthis.com. I have a Patreon right now. It's $7 a month. We're doing some really interesting stuff there. I'm about to upload an audio episode about an entity that everybody loves talking about. I'm not going to tell you who it is, but if you can't get enough of the main podcast and you want to check out some new stuff, I put up extra content, at least two every month, up on patreon.com/whatmagicisthis. So please head there. And if you don't like the paying every month kind of thing, I have a PayPal Me account. Just go to the website, click on the PayPal Me logo, and you can donate $5, $10, $20, any amount of money. It is totally cool. All of those things, every single one of those is available at whatmagicisthis.com. So Devin, I can't wait to talk again. I think we're going to talk in a couple of days or something.
Yeah. It's going to be great. I can't wait to pick your brain and all of the books that live inside there.
So too many. It's too many. I actually think it might be unhealthy.
You're like that gif of Merlin where it's like higgity-piggity and you're just right. Shrinking and downloading books right into your head.
Yesterday I was literally reading. I read one book and then I put it down and then I started another book and then I read that and then I picked up the book that I started. Anyway, it was, I don't know if it's healthy. I might need to take a year vacation.
Hashtag wizard problems.
Yeah, exactly. I can't wait to be on your show. This has been so much fun. My God, we've been recording for 2 hours, and I think that we could have recorded at least for another two. We could have at least donated an hour or concentrated an hour on Gandalf. But Devin, thank you so much for being on What Magic Is. I can't wait to have you back. I really do want to have you back on the show somewhat soon as well. But
please, yeah, I would love to. I want to be on an episode where I get to just listen the whole time. I rambled a bunch. I want to be on one where I get to ask you the quid pro quo, and then I get to just hear you tell me about something.
We'll do it. We'll definitely have one of those as well. Can't wait to have you back on the show. That's the show, everybody. I hope you enjoyed Wizards. I know it's a little bit different than what normally happens on What Magic Is This. I really sometimes just feel like talking about fucking wizards, and I'm so glad that I was able to do so, Devin, and thank you so much for approaching me and wanting to do this. And I apologize for the fact that it took so long, but I'm so happy that we had the opportunity.
Thank you, Douglas. I believe in you. Your magic is real.
Thank you so much. And that's the show, everybody, so come on back. You robed, bearded, staff-carrying, pointy-handed, beautiful people to What Magic Is This. We'll talk about more of this crazy stuff. Until then, I want you all to stay healthy, stay hopeful, and stay luminous. We'll talk at you soon, and can we get a goodbye from the wizard?
No.
Oh, brutal. Evil wizard. Evil wizard is born. This is how they start. This is literally how they start. All right, everybody. Have a good one. We'll speak to you soon. Bye-bye. So you see, you like wizards, eh? All right. I've got a wizard for you. Coming right up. Stay tuned.